Praise the Lord. What a blessing it is to have this opportunity to share with each of you in our Monday Manna class. I give God praise and thanks for each of you for taking out the time in your busy schedules to be with us, to share with us in our Monday Manna. Monday Manna is driven by Exodus chapter 16, verses 4 and 5. Then said the Lord unto Moses, behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate or a certain amount every day, that I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or no. And it shall come to pass that on the sixth day they shall prepare that which they bring in, and it shall be twice as much as they gather daily. Amen. God tells the children of Israel to prepare themselves for a flood, a rain of bread, manna, bread that would be unrecognizable, but it would supply their need. He teaches them to look for this bread, to anticipate this bread, and praise the Lord, that bread came. And every day they were fed. And so when we take that and compare it to where we are now in life, we must understand that the Lord also has bread for us, a daily bread. Jesus says, I am the bread that came from heaven. Your fathers, your ancestors ate bread in the wilderness. But Jesus said, I am the bread that came from heaven. And so he teaches us to eat of that bread and to partake in that bread. And that bread is the word of God. When Jesus teaches them to pray, he says, give us this day our daily bread. And I just want you to know that God has a word for you daily. He has something that he wants you to feast on, to meditate on, to ponder upon every day. The Bible says, let this book of the law not depart out of thy mouth, but therein you should meditate day and night. And so each of you friends, you need to feast on the word of God. Embrace God's word, because God's word, it is a lamp unto our feet. It is a light unto our path, and each and every one of us need it every day. And so that's why we do Monday Manna. Thank you for being diligent with us as we transitioned our times. We were doing 6 a.m., but we feel that we could reach a much larger crowd and be a blessing to many more people if we do 6 p.m. every Monday. And so thank you for being with us and being diligent and changing up with us. Today we are in Colossians chapter number 3. We're going to deal with just one verse. There is so much that the Lord shared with me out of verse number 8 of Colossians chapter 3 that I really think we need to discuss as a body of believers. We live in a day when people are, for lack of better terms, petty. We see pettiness all the time. We see pettiness in the workplace. We see pettiness in our churches. We see pettiness among friends and family. And really, the word petty really goes back to what the older people used to call spiteful. Spiteful, going railing for railing or rail for rail, going tit for tat. You do this to me, so I'm going to do that to you. It's really vengeance or being vengeful. That's what pettiness really boils down to. And I think verse 8 of Colossians chapter 3 teaches us as a people what character traits we should embody or possess. It goes without saying that the Christian should not be petty. Right? I want you to put that in the feed tonight. I want you to really write that down. The Christian should not be petty. That shouldn't be what the Christian lives off of. That shouldn't be what the Christian does in their free time. The Christian must embody mercy and kindness and the fruit of the Spirit. We are not to be petty people. At the bare minimum, we should be persons who embody love, who exhibit love, who display love, because that is what the Bible teaches us as Christians. And so, friends, let's look at verse number 8 of Colossians chapter number 3. And again, our Monday manna is only 30 minutes, so if I don't get to finish all of this, I will pick it back up next week, okay? Colossians chapter 3, verse number 8, it says, "But now ye also put off all of these." All right, so that means there's going to be a list of things that we should put off, all right? "But now ye also put off all these: anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth." Read it again, Pastor. "But now ye also put off all these: anger." You know, as Christians, we, the Bible teaches us to be angry, but sin not. But when something goes wrong in our life, our first defense or our first reaction shouldn't be anger. You ever met people, something goes wrong and they're just automatically distraught? They're just angry. That should, as a Christian, we should get a handle on that. That when things go wrong in our lives, anger should not be the first reaction we have. We should be sober-minded, right? We should be level-headed. One of the fruit of the Spirit, or one of the embodiments of having the Spirit, is temperance. We should never have a first reaction to just be angry. We should have temperance, which means self-control as Christians. We should never just pop off the handle, you know, and be about it, you know, be all about that rah-rah right away. That's not what God would have us to do. All right. So he says, put off all these: anger. But the next one then is wrath, right? We cannot go around being petty and being vengeful, right? Wanting to get people, or eye for eye, or two for two. I'm going to get you before you get me type thing. That's not what God would have us to do. He teaches us to put away anger, to put away wrath. But then he also teaches us to put away malice, right? To put away malice. As Christians, we cannot harbor hatred. We cannot allow that kind of thing to live in our heart. We cannot allow that kind of thing to live in our spirit. The Bible teaches us to rejoice when we are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Which teaches us that when something happens to us that makes us uneasy, then our decision to be to give it to God and release it to God through rejoicing. We should not harbor that kind of stuff in our heart, right? But then he also teaches us to get rid of blasphemy, speaking against the Holy Spirit, speaking against the workings of the Spirit, speaking against the working of God in another's life. He teaches us to put that away. But then he also teaches us to put filthy communication out of our mouths. We were having a conversation not too long ago about cussing and cursing. And a lot of people were saying, you know, that cussing, using profanity, is not cursing. And because I understand the semantic definitions of both of those words, I agree that cussing is not cursing. But that does not give Christians the right or the privilege to cuss, use profanity, because although it is not cursing, speaking ill to someone and cutting them with a curse, you know, speaking a curse over their lives, it still is filthy communication. All right. And so the Bible teaches us not to curse and bless out of the same mouth, C-U-R-S-E, but it also teaches us not to cuss using profane language, because that's filthy communication. All right. And sometimes I think we try very best to take the scripture but sometimes we take the scripture and switch its meaning so that we can have leeway to do things that are not supported in the scripture, but we try to use the scripture to support them. And so verse number 8 teaches us, it teaches us the things that we have to put off, the things that we must get rid of, the things that we must set to the side. And I want you to put in the feed tonight or write it down on your paper. You can do this. You can do this. You can put away these things. Number one, because God wouldn't have told us in this scripture to put it away if he knew that we could not do it, right? You can put these things away. You are going to need the help of the Holy Spirit. You're going to need the Holy Ghost living inside of you, amen, to put away anger, to put away wrath, to put away malice, to put away blasphemy, to put away filthy communication. You're going to need the Holy Spirit. You cannot do that just you wake up one day and say, hey, I'm going to quit doing this. You're going to need the Spirit, right? Because the works of the flesh are made manifest. And so the Bible teaches us that the Spirit is the thing that is going to help us or enable us, empower us to walk this walk, right? And talk this talk, but you can do it. You have a role to play, right? And the role that you must play in this process is being submissive to the Holy Spirit and listening to him when he tells you, don't get angry about that. Just be cool, be calm. Don't say that. You know, yes, I know they did you wrong, but you do right, right? Overcome evil with good. The Holy Spirit is going to talk to you and teach you and lead you into all truth. But as Christians, we have to submit. We have to submit to the guidance of the Holy Spirit. Okay, and so that's verse 8, but packed in verse 8 is a lot of things, and I want to take the next 17 minutes to really go through what verse number 8 is really saying to the believer. As I mentioned earlier, as Christians, there are certain behaviors that we must embody. I tell people all the time that we are the only Bible that some people will read, and so we cannot be out here just doing any and everything. The Apostle Paul tells one of the churches that he helped to establish, he teaches them, he says, walk worthy of the profession wherewith you have been called. So each of us, I'd like to think of it like Jacob and Esau, each of us has a nation in whom we will reach. There are a certain group of people that I am going to reach. There are a certain group of people that Sister Charlotte or Sister Tina there are certain groups of people that we are all going to reach. I'm not going to be able to reach everybody that you reach because the Lord has called us into different fields. Primarily, I am in education. Some of you on the call may be in nursing. And so there are groups of people that you will reach, amen, and there are groups of people that I will reach. But we are on the same team. We're all working together for the glory of God. But you cannot reach your people and reach the nation that God wants you to reach. And I'm not talking about being a preacher. I'm talking about being a Christian, right? You're not able to go out and produce and bear fruit if you are not embodying everything that a Christian is, right? You can't be out here in the workforce, out here in the world being spiteful and expect to reach the people, amen, that God would have you to reach. You can't be out here full of hatred and full of envy and jealousy and malice and just being ugly. You can't reach the nation of people that you need to reach or that God would have you to reach if you have those kinds of things harboring inside of you, right? One of the things that we must understand is that vengeance is not ours, right? Vengeance is not ours. I went through something, I think, very traumatic this summer as it comes to working. And there were some things that were done that I knew were wrong. And it just wasn't right. But rather than being vengeful, rather than taking matters into my own hands, at my place of employment and trying to get people back, I took the high road. You know, I listened, I heard, I knew it wasn't true. And then I prayed about it, asked the Lord to vindicate me. And when God vindicated me, I was able to move. I was able to get new employment, and it worked out for my good, more pay, more, you know, working during the summers. It just was a better situation. And had I been vengeful and done things to get back at people, then I would have missed out on what God had for me. And so, friends, I am telling you this because I've lived through this, that sometimes you just have to allow, be still and let the Lord fight your battle, right? You cannot be spiteful. You can't be vengeful. You can't be full of hatred. You just have to sit and allow God to be God and let God work things out in his own way and in his own time. If you will look at the book of Romans, chapter number 12, Romans chapter number 12, and we're going to look at verses 17 through 21. Romans chapter 12, verses 17 through 21. Hear ye the word of the Lord. It says, recompense to no man evil for evil. So in other words, what the Apostle Paul is teaching the church at Rome is, don't try to get back at people, right? Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men, right? Verse 18, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men, all right? The Bible teaches us to be at peace with all men. And I like that part. It says, if it be possible, as much as lieth in you. He says, with everything you got, I want you to live at peace with all men. People of God, saints of God, children of God, we should not be fighting each other. We should not be warring with each other. We should not be going back and forth trying to do this, trying to do that. And that was something that I really had to grapple with the earlier part of this year, because sometimes people just make it, they try to make it really hard for you, and you find yourself going back and forth and fighting and throwing up blows, and this person says this, and then you try to defend yourself and say, one thing the Lord taught me is be quiet. You don't have to defend everything. You everything does not solicit a response. You know, sometimes things are happening and people are saying things and you want to defend your name but sometimes the more you talk, the deeper you fall into quicksand. Sometimes you just have to really just take the scripture, swallow some wooden nickels, close your tongue, amen, and just be at peace with all men. Sometimes being at peace with all men is saying nothing and just letting things play out. Amen. And I know that's hard for us because, again, our nature is, you said this to me, I'm going to say this to you. I'm not letting nobody talk to me that way. You know, and so we kind of go this tit for tat thing. But God is teaching us, right? We're growing in grace. God is teaching us. Amen. That you sometimes you just have to be at peace with all men, and sometimes you just got to be quiet. Amen. Amen. Verse 19 of Romans chapter 12, it says, dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves. All right. But rather give place unto wrath. Don't give space for anger. I need you to hear that. Don't give space for anger. Don't allow things in your life and don't allow situations to make you harbor anger and act off of emotions and be impulsive and just be flying off the handle and flipping your lid and all. Don't give space to that. Amen. You have to, as an individual, control you. Somebody say amen. 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 The Bible teaches us again, for it is written, vengeance is mine, verse 9 of Romans 12, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. I was telling my sister that not too long ago that there are certain circumstances and situations in life, amen, where you just have to let God work it out. You know, the more you stir in it, the more you try to seek understanding, the more you try to get other people to understand you, the more hellacious it becomes. Sometimes stirring in the pot just makes matters worse. Sometimes you just got to take your hands off of it, pray about it, and allow God to work it out in his own time. You don't need to explain it. You don't need to fuss it out. You don't need to, as the young people say, pull up, You don't need to catch nobody outside. How about that? You don't need to do any of that. You need to just chill out and allow God to work through that. Amen. Verse 20 says, therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome of evil, but overcome or conquer evil with good. God, every time something bad happens to you, your response should be something good. Amen. I want that to sink in. Rewind it, Pastor. Say it again. Excuse me. Every time something bad happens to you, you ought to respond with something good. Amen. You shouldn't, your first line of defense should not be anger. And you punch me, I'm gonna punch you. No, the Bible says, when they ask the question, how often should I forgive? Jesus says 70 times 70. You know, nobody is counting, right? 4,900 for forgiveness. Or 4,900 times that you extend forgiveness, right? But what Jesus was really teaching us is that forgiveness is endless. Forgiveness is something that is ongoing always. Amen. It's not something that you do today, but you don't have to do tomorrow, right? Jesus says, if someone smites you on one cheek, what are you supposed to do? Turn the other. And I'm teaching on this and taking my time and being intentional about this lesson because what God has for you, sometimes you can forfeit it or abort it because of anger, because of malice, because of hatred, because of vengeance, or because of pettiness. You can sometimes miss out on what God has for you because you're harboring all this stuff, right? Right. And if you got all of this stuff in your heart, you don't think you're going to heaven. Only the pure in heart. Amen. Somebody put that in the feed. Only the pure in heart shall see God. You can't have all this ugliness in your heart and expect, amen, to one day be with the Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, listen to this. Amen. Time is running from me, but listen to this. The way of the world is vindictive. If you don't know that, please let me be the first to tell you that the way of the world is vindictive. If you get me, I got to get you. Right. If you do something to me, I got to do something to you. Right. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. But as Christians, we cannot become accustomed to this way because Jesus teaches us to love our enemies. Right. I know so many of you are familiar with it, but we'll go there today. Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. We're going to look at verse 43 through 45. Matthew 5, verse 43 through 45, it says, ye have heard that it hath been said, thou shalt love thy neighbor and hate thine enemy. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. You do me, I got to do you, right? But I say unto you, love your enemies. Oh, my goodness. Bless them that shall curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them that despitefully use you and persecute you. Verse 45, that ye may be the children of your Father, which is in heaven, for he maketh his sun to rise on the evil and on the good, and he sendeth rain on the just and on the unjust. Right? And so what he is teaching us is, he says, I want you to do something different. Right? That's really what we are called to as Christians, to be different. Right? He says, I have called you a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. What? Right. To shew forth the praises of him that have called you out of darkness into this marvelous light. God has called us to be different. He's called us to be agents of change. Right? One epistle, he says, I have called you, amen, to turn this world upside down. Amen. But we cannot turn this world upside down if we, as the people of God, are doing what the world is doing. We can't live like the world and expect to change the world, right? We have to be a different people. Amen. And so one of the things that or one of the ways that we must show our difference is how we treat others. Right? You can't be hating on your enemies and trying to get back at your enemies, and somebody curse you, so you gonna curse them, and somebody hate you, so you're gonna hate them. No, if we're going to be agents of change and if we're going to truly be disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ, we gotta love our enemies. No matter what they do to us, we gotta love them, right? Amen. No matter what they say, no matter how they treat us, we just got to love them. Amen. When people speak bad of us, we got to speak well of them. Amen. When people do wrong to us, we got to do good to them. Amen. And I know it's easier said than done, because again, our nature and the way of the world is vindictive and it likes to get back. But people of God, you cannot afford to miss out on what God has for you because you're trying to get somebody back, or you're trying to be petty, or you're trying to do somebody in. You ain't got time for that. Amen. You don't have time for that. You should not spend your energy on that. Amen. Because the more we fight among ourselves, the less we are impacting hell's kingdom. The enemy's kingdom is continuing to enlarge and continue to enlarge itself. And it's continuing to destroy our young people. It's continuing to destroy our streets. It's continuing to destroy lives at large with drugs and so many other things. And the more we as Christians fight among ourselves, the less of an impact we are having on the world and the less of an impact we are having on Satan's kingdom. Amen. Amen. So Jesus is teaching us that if you want to impact the world, if you want to impact the kingdom and turn the world upside down, you got to love folk. Amen. You got to overcome evil with good. Amen. 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 And again, it takes the Holy Ghost, amen, to help you to do this. You cannot do it just within yourself, but it is possible to do. It is possible to do. It is possible to do. Amen. Amen. And all of us have a role and a part to play. Amen. We all have a role and a part to play. We cannot just be out here being vindictive. We cannot just be out here saying anything, doing anything, treating people anyway, harboring ugliness in our heart. That's not what God would have for us. He wants for us to love each other. He wants for us to extend kindness, right? And even if you see someone that is supposed to be saved and they've been overcome with a struggle, or they've been overcome with an issue, it's not your job to beat them up. The Bible says, it teaches us in the book of Galatians that if you see your brother overtaken by a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness. Even when we are correcting one another in Christendom, as Christians, as the children of God, we have to do so using mercy. We have to do so with kindness. We have to do so, amen, in a humble way. Amen. You can't just fly off the handle even in correcting someone in righteousness. There's a way to do it. Amen. My mom always taught us that it's not what you say, it's how you say it. Amen. And as Christians, we have to be so very careful with how we treat one another. Amen. We have to be careful of how we treat one another. Somebody put that in the feed today. Be careful how you treat one another. Amen. Because God would have us not to be angry, not to be full of malice, not to be full of wrath, not to be full of blasphemy and filthy communication, but to be full of love. But to be full of love. That's what God wants for us. He wants us to be full of love. Full of love. No matter the circumstance, no matter the cause, God wants us to be full of love. And I pray that this word today blessed your heart. I know it blessed me. Next week, we'll pick up and finish out all of that is packed in verse 8 of chapter 3 of the book of Colossians. God bless you all. I pray God's richest blessings be upon you all in Jesus' name. Allow this word to fall in our hearts that it might produce fruit in its season. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all and good day.